for being here. I'm Polly Jeffcoat, I'm the interim vice provost for the library. And it is my sincere pleasure to introduce Joan Lippincott today, who will present on digital scholarship partnering for the future. Joan serves as Associate Executive Director of the Coalition for Network Information, located in Washington, D.C. See a little bit about CNI, in case you don't know about them or aren't aware about what they do. It is a joint program of the Association of Research Libraries, ARL, and EDUCAUSE, and is dedicated to supporting the transformative promise of digital information technology for the advancement of scholarly communication and the enrichment of intellectual productivity. Wow, that is amazing. And UConn Library is a member, a proud member of CNI. Joan is widely published author and frequent conference speaker. You can find her publications listed with many links out to full text, I was happy to see, on the CNI website, and I encourage you to go look at some of those. And I have been fortunate to hear her speak on a variety of topics, from library space design to digital scholarship. And she recently moderated a terrific panel at the ARL CNI Fall Forum on realizing the library organization to meet research needs. So we are truly fortunate that she stopped by Storrs to visit with us on her way to the CNI ARL Digital Scholarship Planning Workshop, which I think some of you all are going to. Jennifer's going. Sarah, you're So Joan is past chair of the Association of College and Research Libraries, ACRL, New Publications Board, and serves on the boards of the New Media Consortium, Portal, Reference Librarian, and the Networked Digital Library of Theses and Dissertations, and is on the advisory board of the Journal of Learning Spaces and the Horizon Report. And if you all are familiar with the Horizon Report, there's also a library edition that came out earlier this year. And it's a great publication that's also available full text PDF on the New Media Consortium site. So prior to joining CNI in 1990, Joan was a librarian at Cornell, Georgetown, and George Washington Universities, and SUNY at Brockport. She received her PhD in higher education and planning from University of Maryland, MLS from SUNY
Geneseo,
and her BA from Vassar. And so Joan, she doesn't know this, but she's one of my librarian heroes. So if something interesting is happening, you will find her name associated with it in some way. I always look when I see something, I'm like, I know she's in here somewhere. So it is with great pleasure that I introduce Joan.
What a generous introduction. Thank you so much. And I'm really delighted to be here. I've never been on this campus, which is kind of amazing. So that's a treat for me as well. So I'm going to give you an overview for starting out with some projects in digital scholarship, then talk about libraries' role, and really look at it from a variety of angles and leave time for discussion, questions. If you'd like to, if something's either unclear or you'd like to stop me at any point, we're a small group, just raise your hand or just start speaking. It won't bother me. I encourage you to let me know if something's unclear or you'd like me to stop and... So, one thing that I did want to point out is our website at www.cni.org. Whatever you're working on, if it has some connection with the digital, you'll find a wealth of information there. We do two big meetings a year where we have up to 40 sessions, and we do a small amount of videotaping and Camtasia, VoiceOver, PowerPoint, but a lot of people also just put up their PowerPoint files. And I actually use it as a reference because I can't get to all the sessions myself. And if I want to know some good projects, say on data science or on learning spaces or on repositories, I go to our own website and see what's going on. And I encourage you to come and take a look. So let's see what I did that this should be the simplest thing. I think what I have to do.
Is the keyboard not working?
Yeah, it's not working. Okay, that time it worked. Fine. Okay, so I wanted to just start out with some examples of what's going on. What are faculty and researchers doing that I characterize as digital scholarship? And this project is out of the University of Oregon. So these are some faculty, anthropologists, archaeologists who work in, their field work is in Mongolia. And they're doing the first surface map of archaeological sites in Mongolia. And they've created this website with various types of maps and a lot of images that go with the maps. Now, these researchers are probably going to write articles in peer-reviewed journals on some of their research, but you can't incorporate all of the photographs or all of the maps or make the maps interactive or zoom in and zoom out in most traditional journal articles. So it's really important for many areas of scholarship to have these enhanced technologies that really help us get a better handle on their research. Emory University has one of the longer-lived centers for digital scholarship. And I really like their website because they give really good descriptions of their projects. This is just a small portion, but it was all I could fit on, you know, the one screen capture. So, for example, The Sacred Matters is a magazine of public scholarship. And as we know, in many fields, a lot of funders are saying, we not only want you to do the academic peer-reviewed article, we want you to translate some of your research for the public. The second one listed, The Southern Spaces, is a peer-reviewed journal, but it's a multimedia journal. So it's enhanced in this digital form. And the last one on this screensaver is developed from a map from the 1676 plan of Rome. It's a virtual experience and a zoomable version of the map. So you can see these are not the standard things that you could find in a monograph or a print or even an e-journal article. They're enhanced forms of scholarship that enable researchers to look at information in new ways, to demonstrate or show their readers what things look like, allow them to interact with materials, and it enhances the scholarship. One of the observations that both Cliff Lynch, my executive director, and I have made is that use of geographical information systems or geolocation systems is just expanding into so many disciplines. And history is one of those that has really taken this up. So I do a lot of scanning of a lot of sources just to see interesting things that I might use as examples in talks or articles or whatever. And I came across this description, Invasion of America. Before I went to the project, I thought, what is this? Is this some kind of 9/11 conspiracy thing or whatever? So it attracted me by the title, so I clicked on it. What is it? It's the European settlement of the American continent. And it's just, you know, to me, fascinating. At the bottom, it has the slider. Do you see the timeline at the bottom? And so on the left is, you know, the earlier years, and you can slide, and you just use the cursor, and you can slide this along and see the progression of the Europeans as they settled the North American continent. So this is produced by researchers, but you can see the applications in teaching and learning. If you were a student in high school or even in college in a US history class, wouldn't it make much more of an impact on you if you used this map? not just saw it on a screen, but as a student, actually worked with it and looked at it and thought about it, rather than just having a static map in a textbook. So this is why I think some of these developments are so important. They allow us to answer new questions, to use information in new ways, and to increase engagement with information. They're also really important in tracking developments. So there was a lot of use of big data in tracking disease and epidemics. This one is of the Ebola in Liberia tracking project. And you'll see that this is housed at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill Library. And you know, this is exceedingly important in the health sciences to understand how diseases are spreading, and it helps both the doctors but also community health workers understand where they're needed and what remedies or interventions they should make. Now, moving to another arena, most of you in this room probably know about the HathiTrust Research Center. And so there's this, you know, enormous number of digitized books, many of which are out of copyright. They're older materials. And what they've done is set up this center. I believe it may only be available to institutions that are members of HATI, but a researcher can write to them or contact them and say, I'm interested in getting an idea of the pattern of women accused of murder, for example, and going back to, say, the 17th century and working up. Can you find occurrences of those, you know, they work with the researcher to construct some kind of a search term or use some kind of software analysis to look for strings of words or whatever and produce reports from this enormous corpus of materials. And so they are set up to do a relatively small number of projects per year, but I think this may be one of the ways that we see digital scholarship developing. There may be more centers that are jointly funded to do highly specialized research in some areas, since at least for the near future, most even research libraries won't be able to master every type of software or analysis and have every type of expertise. I think there will be a set of tools that are going to become more standard, more generic, that almost any research library will have staff that can advise and work with researchers on certain tools, but there will be others that are more specialized, or for smaller institutions, perhaps we'll see these kinds of centers developing in other areas. Kind of, really, we already have ICPSR in social sciences for data, and so these it isn't a brand new concept like this. Did any of you see the article in the Chronicle a week or so ago? And I think there have been a couple follow-ups about criticizing the digital humanities and what a bunch of, you know, waste of time and energy and all. I have to say, I was infuriated by that article. Not because someone isn't entitled to his opinion, but I thought that a scholar, a bona fide faculty member at a university, which the author was, should certainly have a little bit better understanding of what digital humanities encompasses these days. And I thought, in my view, to be honest, he was showing a bit of ignorance at the narrow way he construed digital humanities. So this would be an example of digital humanities that was not included in the type of projects that he mentioned. So this is mapping Gothic France. The key faculty members, one was from Columbia University, he's quite senior and maybe retired at this point, he spoke at a CNI meeting many years ago. Another is a more junior faculty member at Vassar, who have worked on this project for many years. And some of the cathedrals in that were built in the Gothic period, or the Gothic style in France, maybe they were never completed, or maybe they were bombed during the war, etc. And so what they're doing is reconstructing them in the way that they would have been complete as originally planned. And one of the things that I like about this project is that in the summer, at least they used to take teams of students into the field. They'd take them to France, and the students would help take the measurements and input the data to help do the these constructions in 3D representations. And there's so many projects in digital scholarship that do involve students, both undergraduates and graduate students, where faculty, librarians, information technologists are working with both undergraduates and graduate students. So you can see, again, this is both research and useful in teaching and learning. It reminded me earlier today when I learned about one of the projects that's going on in the Greenhouse Studios about, was it a cathedral where the ceiling was a beautiful artistic representation, but at the time they're doing the representation, it had been covered over, or vice versa. And so those are the kinds of things that a project like this could illustrate, because in the digital form you actually could show it both ways if you chose to. At Boston College, there's been a project for several years called Digital Dubliners, where an English faculty member is working with his students in classes over the years to create what they call a totally new reading experience. He also takes the students to Dublin. I don't know if it's in the summer or during spring break or something like that. So they're mapping the streets, you know, that James Joyce wrote about. They're doing, you know, essays. They're doing things about the characters and about the buildings that were referenced, etc. So this is the kind of engaging work, I think, that is very meaningful to many students today. In addition, they're producing students from the humanities that have the tools to go out into the workforce and find jobs where people are looking for individuals with technology skills, as well as the ability to think critically and analyze and write. So it's the whole package. And this one at Lafayette College, you know, small liberal arts college in Pennsylvania. The faculty members' research is on a neighborhood that existed in eastern Pennsylvania, a large town or small city, that was decimated through urban renewal when a highway was built through the town. Now, this happened in many, many American cities, and certain neighborhoods were just, in effect, demolished. Well, in Easton, it was a Lebanese-American neighborhood that was destroyed, and the people just scattered to the suburbs or other areas. And so this faculty member, that's her research, but she's using the students in her classes to create a map of what the area looked like, where different families lived. The students are going out trying to find people still living to take oral histories and integrate them into this project, scanned photographs and those kinds of things. You know, really, really interesting project that they're doing. Now, I've mentioned all of these people, and I'm going back to that first slide I showed about the Mongolian project. This is a list, and it isn't even, I think, quite the full list, from their website, of all of the people involved in that project. And you'll see the faculty and some photographers. I'm going to have to go to the screen to read this, though. And then we have a list of University of Oregon libraries. The MAP GIS librarian, the digital collections coordinator, the Center for Media and Educational Technologies, a website technical lead and interactive media, a visual resources librarian, and a research assistant, all listed as being from the University of Oregon libraries. So, you know, this is a big effort and a lot of people's skills incorporated in this project. I personally have never heard of a digital humanities or a digital scholarship initiative that's been done by one person. They are team initiatives, and they bring together people with a variety of skills. And that's what genuine collaboration is about, where people have different skill sets. They respect each other's skill sets, but they're all working towards a common goal, which is the creation of this kind of project in this case. Now, one of the things, though, that continues to be a challenge in academe is whether or not these new forms of scholarship are going to be accepted for promotion and tenure. And at this point, two major national organizations, scholarly societies, the MLA, Modern Language Association, the American Historical Association, have come out with guidelines for evaluating digital projects. Now, that does not necessarily mean that an individual academic institution is going to honor these, but they exist. And I think that eventually, as generations change and as the world changes and as scholarship changes, from my point of view, it's inevitable that these forms of scholarship will become accepted broadly. I think in the sciences, it's just not a question at this point. And the sciences in information, we have someone from the health sciences here. I've been around a long time in libraries, and they were always leading in technology and digital information. And you wouldn't think twice. They would look at you like you were crazy if you said that something that was data intensive or talked about data visualizations or whatever wasn't accepted as tenure level research. I mean, that would just be nuts, am I right?
Well,
depends.
I think academe is conservative in every area. Yeah, certainly data is accepted as something you produce as a researcher, but for promotion and tenure, I think publications and committees is still what you...
Well, publications, yes, but in those publications, I would think many of them are based on work that has not been done with big data, manipulation of data,
yes,
data visualization.
Yes, that's true, and increasingly data sets are also being uploaded with the article.
Right.
Yes, right.
Yes.
But I would also, as I'm also in the sciences, so mm-hmm. I'm a librarian, and as I'm looking at your examples, I'm thinking, there are areas in science that could benefit from this as well, because
yes.
While the focus is on peer-reviewed scholarship, the typical peer-reviewed journal does not have space for this kind of stuff. It's the same idea as you were talking about in humanities, where
yes.
It's focused on specific things, and all the details that went into making it happen,
they
often don't see the light.
That's right.
So.
But some of these things exist. I was at a conference several years ago where someone from an optical journal was showing a manipulable table in the journal from their society. And so I think it's happening. These things are developing. And a number of years ago, when I went back to Cornell for a conference, one of the researchers was saying it used to be that, and it was in agriculture, and they were talking about, I can't remember, it was something orange, it was either tomatoes or oranges. And he was saying that at the start of his career, you would have a sample of maybe 100 species or 100 whatever, and you would do a data analysis of that. And now he said, you can't do that. And I don't know if it was a genetic analysis or whatever, but he was saying, we're doing this in like the tens of thousands. You know, and this is what I mean by data intensive research. It's just a different way of approaching. Just like searching Haunted Trust is different from searching, 100 books. It's just a very different process of doing. So what do digital scholarship programs do? And I'm going to focus on digital scholarship programs in libraries here. And in my view, and this is my conceptualization of this, at the top is new forms of scholarly communication. That's at the heart of it. But with implications and involvement of teaching and learning in many cases, involving technologies and tools, software and tools. Importantly, in a library, it means expertise is available. This is one of the things that's different from a program that may be out in an academic department where students who take a course or researchers who've chosen to work together on a project might trade expertise, but in the library, they make expertise available more broadly. And then usually it involves some physical spaces and certainly some virtual spaces. Now the spaces may be dedicated spaces or they may be spaces that are often used. For example, you have to have a place to hold workshops. You have to have a place to hold consultations. Whether it's in a place called a center or a lab or a whatever, or a greenhouse, there's a lot of variation. But this is what I mean about a digital scholarship program in a library. And why are libraries good places? I really strongly believe that they are. Well, if libraries support research and scholarship, and I don't know anyone who would argue with that, why wouldn't they support e-research and digital scholarship? I mean, I can't imagine what an argument would be that they would exclude that from their support. They bring together expensive technologies for use by a wide variety of campus departments. Some programs limited to certain disciplines like humanities, others have humanities and social sciences, and some have programs that serve all disciplines. And they bring together this expertise so that it's available to all and support graduate and often undergraduate. Not always, there are some programs that are just for graduate students and faculty. But if you're a graduate student and you know what the job market is like and you aren't even aiming for a tenure track faculty position or you know that you have maybe a 10% chance of getting one and you want to prepare yourself maybe to work in a museum or in some other kind of cultural institution and you know you'd be more marketable if you had high level digital skills, this is a place where you can go and work on something where your faculty advisor may not be able to help you, or people in your department may not have the expertise, but you can come to the library and take advantage of the expertise that's available there. So we held a workshop in 2014. You had to apply to come, and we selected 20 institutions, well, I guess it was 2021. And we did, they had to fill out a form, that's where we got the data before they came. And this is what we found out. So this is a few years old, and ARL is doing this profile, the series of profiles on digital scholarship, one by one from institutions. Probably you have a profile in there already. But they all consult on digital technologies, and the next two were digital preservation curation and workshops, and very shortly after the digital project management. There were lots and lots of other services, and the average number of services offered by each one was 7. And here are some others. You know, it was again 3 years ago, so there were 9 with makerspaces plus 2, so 11. But a number of them said, well, we're going to have that in the next few years. Whether a makerspace is included in a digital scholarship center or is a separate part of the library, it varies a lot. And what was really at least as interesting were all the things people wrote in. And if we had listed these all on the form, we would have gotten more responses. Now at the lunch break, I asked people to fill out just a little card with the top 3 things they thought they'd accomplished and the top 3 challenges. And almost to every single one had community building as one of their top 3 successes. It was really quite remarkable. And I do believe that it's one reason space, I also had asked them at the end if they thought space was important, and every single one attending, to my surprise actually, said yes. And I think there is a connection between community building and spaces, physical spaces. I don't think it's the only way to build community, but I think it's a factor. By the way, I'd be happy to leave a copy of my slides for anyone who wants to go back and look at them. The types of staff, this is also quite interesting. Librarians and information technology professionals, they all had people from each group, and then equally, undergrad and grad. These are not users, these are staff, these are people hired to serve, to work in these programs. Really interesting, 4 to 6 types of staff per center. I thought Brown does a really nice job of, on their website, how can I work with them, and they have the different kinds of topics that they, and expertise. I think if you click on those, you come up with the names of the people you can contact. Graduate Student Fellows, these are the University of Virginia Scholars Lab. They have this nice little area, a lounge, where, again, a way to create community for them. They have 2 different graduate fellow programs there. And at McMaster, which is outside of Toronto in Canada, on the right you'll see a fellow's workstation. So they also have a fellowship program. And on the left, I was there, I spoke there, they had a kind of open house day, and so they had all their different tools and things laid out on some of the tables. And doesn't, I think, normally look quite that way. And this was the workshop in the morning. This is an Arduino workshop, and then I spoke in the afternoon. So these are reconfigurable tables. You can move them around. There's plenty of power and access. And they also had a break area, so you could bring your lunch or have coffee. It's very small, but it's another way to create community. At Northeastern University, this is also a setup that's somewhat typical. I've heard they're going to do more renovation, but when I was there, this isn't that old. But you can see there are places for consultation, for doing projects, and at the back, the orange, a place to view a project. You can get a small group together or even a small workshop back in that space. At Duke, at the Edge, which is a very large digital scholarship center, on the left, those yellow stools are clustered. You can't see to the left of them is a whole whiteboard wall. I mean, the whole length of that hallway. So the stools are just so people can sit and, work on the whiteboard. And to the right are their project rooms. And they're similar to what you're doing here in the greenhouse, that people can reserve these. They have to say what they're working on. They can reserve them for longer periods of time. I don't remember if the max is like 3 months or something like that, but they're experimenting with that at the Edge. Not every one of those is reservable, but a certain number. And on the right is their geospatial lab. I like the way they've put up the graphs that some of the students have done. It's larger than that. Now, one of the things that is really important is whether to have a digital scholarship program in a public area or a key card access or some kind of controlled access. When they renovated the Young Research Library, which is the Humanities and Social Sciences Library at UCLA, they decided to make it open. I was there in the summer, so this photo was taken in the summer, and they were holding an NEH-funded Digital Humanities Institute there, and people were working on projects. But during the school year, what they'd hoped would be a place where graduate students would work on high technology projects, they basically found they were absolutely taken over by undergraduates doing, just regular homework. And so it's, there's not a right or wrong here, but it's something that you need to figure out. What is the purpose, and what are the priorities, really, for the space, and what will work and what might not work. also UCI, really nice facilities on the left. These are all contiguous, one big floor, so a place where you could have public presentations, you could take the chairs out and have a stand-up reception. And on the right, I just loved this hallway with the displays, the big digital displays, and they were showing some of the projects that the people there for the Institute were working on. Another really beautiful facility is at Georgia State University in the middle of Atlanta, and it's called The Curve. And I was there at the ALA Midwinter meeting last January and sat in some of those chairs, and they did a presentation of some of the projects that they are working on. A lot of them involved with teaching and learning and some with research. And behind that screen are project areas. And so students come and work. There's specialized software on the computers in those areas, and they've been, you know, very successful with class projects and other things. Many of you are aware the Hunt Library at North Carolina State University is a real leader in high-end technologies. On the left is data visualization in their enormous studio, and that's a transportation visualization. So they have engineers working on highway development, and that's one of the things they have there. And on the right, this is more in a public area, and this is a weather visualization. It's almost like artwork to me. When we were there a few months ago, they had Persian literature. They had book covers from I think it was Persian women authors. Anyone there remembers? Something like that. But it was a beautiful, colorful display. And I think that was...
Who manages that display? Is it rotating basis?
Yes. That's a really good and important question. So they have someone who is the point person for managing those displays. I don't remember his name, but he was talking during the tours. He was talking to a group of people about his role and how he has evolved the way he handles this to make it more manageable. It is a lot of work. And so there are different times of year that different things are scheduled, and you know, and there are processes by which you can apply to have your information or your representations on those screens, et cetera. But he manages the actual getting it ready and, you know, making it available. And yes, they are rotating, or some of them are rotating displays and not all. And this is their makerspace in their older library, the Hill Library. They wanted to open it up and make it very visible, which it is. So I'm not going to read this to you, but one day I was just thinking, well, it's really hard to say to people what is or isn't in some of these spaces, and it really is a slice and dice. I have never been in one that's the same as another. It really is very dependent on the needs of your community, on what gaps you can fill, what are the high priorities, what is the skill set of your staff, what is your space, et cetera, et cetera. One of the things, though, that is really important is that people know what you have and what you offer. And one of the ways you do this, and I really noticed the glass walls of the Greenhouse Studio, because this is one of the ways people do it. They make the work visible, so people say, oh, that's interesting, what's going on there. At the University of Calgary, when they built their library, they weren't thinking of that. And so their visualization wall is in a room with a wooden door with a little sign, and who would know that it's there? So one of the things they do on a rotating display, this display is probably as tall as I am, is working with big data, and then the next screen is experience the studio, and then the next one says it's on the second floor and where it's located. And then there are other things on that are rotated on that display, but you're telling people where it is, or you're conveying information on your website. This is the University of Georgia. I know graphically it may not be that clear, but I liked how they represent here's what we do in research, here's what we do in pedagogy, and we also have a certificate program, which is becoming more popular, to get, you know, a certain number of courses and then you get a certificate. This is in digital humanities. In addition, this is the same website. They list all the software they have available. I think it probably goes on to another screen, but I think that's a very smart idea too. If you're in your office or in your dorm room, you can find out what's available and decide whether you come over. And also using photos or really bright, you know, representations. This is Florida Institute of Technology. I haven't gotten to visit that, but they've, this is just a screen capture from their website. They've also sent me some photos. And it's just really a beautiful facility that they're showcasing. But then they also, you can click on all of these things, so their analysis and visualization and their 3D printing and their metadata creation, and you know, follow up and get more detail on their programs. Another way to get your center known is hosting events. Now, this is not a digital scholarship center. Wallenberg Hall was the first entirely high-tech classroom building built at Stanford a little while ago. And when I visited there last year, we got a tour. This was not going on when I was there, but they were showing it on this really big screen. So on election night, a journalism class reserved this enormous space, and they were live blogging the election with all the different news services up on the screen. Now, this is a wonderful kind of campus event and connected to a class. And at Georgia State, they invite students to do a hackathon, a hackers group on campus, to come once or twice a year and use the space for a hackathon. The AUL of the library, Brian Sinclair, who does a lot with this space, said people come in who have never been in the library in their whole, you know, 2 or 3 years on campus. So you're bringing in new user groups and saying, we have some things for you here. I'm just going to go briefly through some slides. We did a paper with the EDUCAUSE Center for Analysis and Research on supporting digital humanities. This is really saying that we need to have digital humanities supported by infrastructure. And by that, I don't just mean networks, but expertise and storage and tools and services. And how do we get there? So we developed this paper. There were about, I don't know, 16 people on working group from both library and information technology backgrounds from different types of institutions. And it's freely available. And basically, it outlines, it's very practical. We're trying to help people move from an early stage of a program to a more established and then high capacity in these areas: organizational models, funding, governance, infrastructure, et cetera, et cetera. And in each of those areas, there's text, and then there are some charts that say, well, in these areas, here's what we think characterizes. Now, this is not the word from on high, but we discussed some of this for like 18 months in this committee with very regular online meetings and came to a consensus of what we thought was important. Here are a few other web resources from CNI. As I mentioned, we have a lot of materials available. And I really want to leave time for some discussion, so I'll wrap it up and ask you to let me know what's on your mind or what you'd like me to talk about further. Thank you.
Yes. So it seems like in, you know, the academia, scholarly communications, it's built around like certain entities of like communication, whether it's a presentation or an article or a scholarly monograph. And so you had highlighted that digital scholarship is spurring these new forms of scholarship. Like, thinking about that, do you see those new forms of scholarship sort of congealing around specific categories or genres, or is it sort of going to be, because right now I see a lot of scatter in terms of the forms those are taking, and that raises questions to me in terms of how that's going to be recognized and the currency it's going to have in scholarly communications.
Right. I probably wouldn't feel comfortable making a prediction about that, and I think it may vary field by field. I do think there's no doubt that GIS technologies will continue for, you know, I think whether a specific GIS technology will be continued, you know, to be favored, that I don't know. But using them as one methodology or one way to represent information, I think will certainly continue. And text analysis has been around already for decades. And even before computers, we had concordances that were done manually. So I also think data visualization, because it allows new patterns to be revealed that with enormous amounts of data, again, the specific software that's used or the specific techniques may change, even in relatively short periods of time, but I expect that will continue to be increasingly valuable. I think everyone's, the two that I hear the most frequently in terms of what's next, both virtual reality and artificial intelligence. So I think I wouldn't, but let me just say, in terms of teaching and learning, maybe not necessarily research, virtual reality, it also, it's been around for a little while. It's one of the things that I experienced for the first time, I don't know, possibly 15 years ago. And I was on campus and I was given a tour, I was taken to another unit, I was visiting the library, but they said, you've got to see this setup in this lab run by information technology. And they had me put on goggles and go into this room, and I walked on the Acropolis. So I not only saw the Parthenon, but other buildings, I saw the paths and the stones on, you know, on the side of the path, all these things. It was quite remarkable. But one of the things that really, and they said, the way it was set up for that particular time was a class in classics or archaeology, whatever it was, I don't remember. They came and then they were to write a paper. They were given assignments of a building or an architectural feature or something. It wasn't like that was the only thing they were using, but they were using that as part of what they, you know, were finding out and to write their paper. But here's what I took away from it, besides the teaching and learning, which always interests me. They mentioned they did not develop the software package for the Parthenon. It came from some other university. And I thought, wow, look at how that can scale. You know, if this can be used all over, not just the US, but really globally, if we can take advantage of this work like we would in any other medium, like a book that could be used anywhere, then we could really create quite a library of these kinds of representations. And it is the type of thing that requires librarian skills in some ways of how do you disseminate them, how do you help connect users that with they exist, how do you accession or how do you purchase them, how do you store them, and how do you apply metadata to them, all of those kinds of things I think are relevant. Thanks. You had a question?
Yes, well, I'm Kathy Labadorf and I'm heading up the Open Educational Resources
yes.
Initiative here. And so right now I'm trying to think how to build community. Here we've had a wonderful year and a half, you know, and the things are happening on campus. But so your when you came to the community building
yes.
part, having the space you were saying,
mm-hmm.
having the space where people can come. But with digital humanities, perhaps there's more of a group
yes.
that needs to meet together, where with OER it might be one or two single faculty member right working on something. And so that's one difference. But in that space,
yes.
you noted the snack area,
right.
but you had the tables that were reservable. Is there also, like with for open textbooks, having the WordPress, the one that Pressbooks.
Right.
You know, would that be similar to something that the you have special software
mm-hmm.
within that digital the Greenhouse Studios? Is the software, is the equipment, do those bring people in, or is it just the space? What's most important?
My answer in terms of especially connecting to community is student groups. So one of the fascinating things that we did, what we call an executive roundtable on OER maybe 2 years ago, we have a report on our website, and I think we did, we either do them like once per meeting, or if we have so much people, so many people trying to register, sometimes we'll do it twice with two different groups of people, but it's only like 20 people who are really doing something in this area. And one university brought a student, and he was from student government. He'd been really active in pushing for OER on the campus. He was very articulate, and it brought to mind a conversation that we had with Nick, and I'm forgetting his last name, from Spark, who works with OpenCon. And that OpenCon is a community. And they're creating a community of students and my impression is junior faculty who are really interested in pushing this forward. And so while with the faculty, maybe what you want is consultation space and perhaps the creating community, I think about a workshop that a colleague, Anu Vedantham, who was at University of Pennsylvania heading their Weigel Information Commons, she's now at Harvard, but at Penn, she did a summer workshop series where faculty talked to other faculty about what they were doing. Particularly, it was a lot of mostly video projects or other kind of media or website projects, things like that. So I think creating community might be workshop series or just a seminar series of faculty talking about to other faculty, the library organizing it, maybe do an introduction, but it's really faculty talking to other faculty of what they see as the benefits, and maybe having the student voice represented too. I think that would be a nice way to create community. Is that helpful?
Sure. That's what a lot of it, that I'm trying to get that going now, actually, having a luncheon so they can all share the,
yes.
what are the barriers,
yes.
what are the things that are working with
right.
or not. But having a specific space then would be good, but probably not as important as it is for digital humanities.
I honestly don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
I haven't seen it. It doesn't mean it wouldn't be valuable. And, you know, with a lot of these spaces, they are reconfigurable.
Hmm.
And people are rethinking all the time what they should be doing or could be doing in the spaces.
Right.
And if it doesn't work, you reconfigure it. You change, you know, what you're doing. So I wouldn't rule it out, for sure.
But I guess what really caught me was that community building was, like, number one.
Yes.
You know?
Yes, it was.
Actually, in all the open conferences I've mm-hmm. gone to, we haven't really talked about community building.
Interesting.
You know, and although there's a lot of participation across
yes.
campus and they're doing a lot of things,
right.
but that particular topic. So I need to look into that more. And it's just very interesting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thinking about all the different types of spaces that you visited and you were doing this environmental scan, were there certain types of spaces that institutions had experimented with and maybe didn't work out quite as they expected, or it didn't work out for them so well, or maybe what kinds of thought process were they going through as they were renovating and reconfiguring library spaces to make them more effective or more aligned with their programs? I'm always thinking kind of learn a lot from like some of the shortcomings of some of these spaces as much as we can from their successes.
I've heard from two places, I know McMaster was one, I can't think of the other, where they have a fellows program or consultations going on and also workshops. And they were finding a lot of conflict with the noise level of the workshops, not noisy, but just, you know, louder, and people really trying to focus on putting a project together. And so either having some kind of a scheduling where you know that certain times are protected for being quieter or whatever, or I think it was at McMaster, they ended up putting in sliding glass panels to wall off the workshop area.
So this was a big open space that they were using for multiple purposes.
Yes. So, and that's true of lots of library spaces, right? Not just digital scholarship centers. The noise levels leaking into other areas is often a problem. And so that would be one.
I think we've come across that quite a bit because so many libraries are constantly pushing for more and more open spaces.
Mm-hmm.
Which you do get that, you know, sense of great sight lines and really nice light, but you lose something in terms of noise levels and private spaces. Is there any kind of backlash against that, like you were talking about in McMaster's example, where people are starting to think about, well, no, actually, we need our open spaces, but we need our like private quiet spaces as well.
Yes, and so they did actually wall it in. And in other, there was a brand new library, University of Toronto, Mississauga, and the idea, as with many libraries, is the information commons on the main floor, you can be talk as much as you want, and then the farther up you go, maybe it had, let's say, four levels, I don't remember, that it's supposed to be quieter as you go up, but they had an open atrium. And so the noise just went up, and they ended up glassing in the atrium. It was expensive. And they had to do it. They really had to do it. Because they didn't want a silent library. They wanted to keep part of it available for collaboration and conversation. So that would be another. I'll bring up one that that isn't really, I think, what you meant, because it's my own opinion and not what I've heard people say. But I've asked a lot of places as they're doing planning, are they planning some type of large screen like this one you see at the Curve? And they'll often say, oh no, we're not gonna do that. We don't have the money, or we don't have this, or we don't have that. And, or they don't know how they would use it or whatever. So it depends on your planning cycle, but some of these places are planning major renovations that really won't even open for, say, 5 years in some cases, if it's really major renovation. And I just think that some of these technologies are going to be less in cost and more useful. So the data visualization studio in the Hunt Library, the brand new library, is very, very high-end technology, very sophisticated, very expensive, and needs high-level technical expertise to run it. So when they decided to put one in Hill, the older library, later, 2 years later, they chose lower-end technology, much less expensive, much easier to run. And the number of classes that are using it is just fantastic. We saw enlarged images of insects, so you can examine them, you know, very closely. Tapestries, you know, from medieval period. So it's a much smaller room. Let's say it was maybe a third of the size of this room. And all around all four walls, you could examine this tapestry.
I know exactly the space you mean, and I think it's just run by cameras.
Yes.
It's just a projection room, and it's amazing. Like very kind of low tech, but low barrier to usage. It's very easy to use. The equipment isn't that expensive, but it gives you that experience of being in the round. And it is like 20 by 20.
And examining in such detail, you know, it's one of the things. The other one is like people doing their dissertation defenses, and they've got really complex data, like really big tables and that kind of thing. You put them up on these screens, you can actually read it. You know, you can actually look at the different cells and see across. You not do that on a page or even on a regular size screen. It's just unreadable. And so I think some of those technologies are really important, and people are overlooking them in many places that I talk to. And yes?
So across the variety of digital projects that people do that you have experienced, how open do they tend to be? So they're clearly openly accessible to people who want to see them, but
right.
How, you know, kind of more in the OER sense, how are they licensed? What do their creators allow?
Yeah.
You know,
oh,
is there,
what
is there
do they allow?
Or are they all over the map?
In terms of, I actually, if I understand your question, I've not been asked that before, and I may just not know the answer. So yes, they're almost entirely open access, but what type of license they have, whether someone can take pieces of the project, if that's what you're asking, I honestly don't know. I've never surveyed that, I've never heard a discussion. Some of them I would think might be quite difficult to kind of take apart, but others, you know, if it were just a matter of taking some images or something from it, would be a different story. So I've never looked in detail at the licenses. I just don't have the answer to that.
For us, Carolyn, the ones that we do here, they're all CC-BY.
Oh, really?
And that's in all the agreements. So
have you looked across at some
I haven't.
Others?
That seems to be the most common. The only time that it seems to be different is when you're dealing with some of the health sciences, because they have some different rules. I do mostly humanities and social science projects, so they haven't hit that problem. But the ones that we've done so far have not had proprietary information, so it's been totally CC-BY. So as long as they give credit where credit is due, we pretty much let them do what they want. But that would be, if I had a scholar who was working on a project with me and had a problem with that, it would be open for discussion. It's not like I would say, oh no, it has to be UI, we're not going to move forward. So I would definitely discuss their concerns and see if we could come to an understanding.
Thank you.
Maybe
on that note, it's a good time to transition to cookies and coffee and more informal conversation. But thank you so much, Joan, for joining us.
Great questions.
And Joan will be around tomorrow morning. She has a smaller group of people still want to carry on conversation.
Exactly.
You do it. You do it.
It's the approach.